Good afternoon. My name is Jay Rothman, and welcome to Real Men, Real Talk, Raw. I am absolutely excited and honored to have in the studio with me Evis Heath coming in from New South Wales, Australia. Welcome to the studio, Evis.
Thank you, Jay. Thank you.
Now, I'm going to have to be really aware. One of my sons, my youngest son, his name is Evan. And I almost welcomed Evan to the studio. So if it should come out that way, it's not intended to disrespect you in any way. But it's just been a 25, 26 year habit of calling someone Evan. So,
it's funny. It's funny you actually mentioned that, Jay, because I've been called Evis. I've been called Evan, like you said. I've been called Ev. I've been called Evelyn, which I think is more a feminine name. But obviously also Elvis, which the name is derived from. So it could be a nice start.
As we wait for those in the community to join us, and I would like to welcome those in our community on your side and my side that join us this evening. I want to acknowledge you in this moment, invite you if you hear anything that you like or love, would love, gently touch your like or love button. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to share them. And also, we'd love to know what part of the globe, where you call home today. Let us know in the comments. I'd love to always acknowledge those of you that are coming in from the United States and outside of the U.S. Means so much to me. We are a global community today, something that 20 years ago, we were not. And so it's, you know, you and I met, it wasn't just too long ago that we connected. And it was an instantaneous, how would you describe it, Evis?
I'm probably sure, Jay, that you get that from a lot of people. But I think if you just remember, and I'm going to say it was exactly no longer than 7 days ago, brother. And the first words I said to you, Jay, if you could remember, was that the tone of your voice caught me. It was the rest pauses and the way that you deliver your message and make your guests feel safe at home in a sacred space that really caught my attention, my brother.
Thank you. Thank you for that compliment. I appreciate that. And since we met, we've had a couple of video chats. We've connected. And of course, I instantaneous said I'd love to have you as a guest on Real Men, Real Talk Raw, because you have a story that is, it's a story that is very common, not uncommon, across the globe. Millions of men and women perhaps have gone through similar challenges that you have faced in your own life. But as a man, being that this is Real Men, Real Talk Raw, I thought this was the appropriate show to bring you in on. And then you said to me, well, I would like to extend an invitation for you to come in on my show and be a guest because you're doing some very similar work down under. And so I believe on the 26th, which is this Thursday, well, it's my Thursday, I'm going to be a guest on your show. So this is an opportunity for both of us to show up. I'm excited to have you here. I'm going to invite you, Evis, as I'd like to push this out to multiple channels across social media, perhaps for you to take some time here and share a little bit about, bring us back to your beginning of time, the part of your life that you're comfortable in to share. What were those defining moments and experiences that really defined and impacted your life as you navigated into adulthood, and how that manifested into the choices and behaviors that guided you for decades. And so again, welcome to the studio.
Thank you again, Jay. I'm feeling very privileged to be a part of your beautiful platform that you've created. And I guess like many of the guests that I ask onto my podcast, The Woke Warrior, we all have a story to share. So I guess I want to try and open up, give you a little bit of an entree before we really dive in deep and get into that meat and veg, which I know Jay will make me get into. But Jay, I come from a rich culture. Many people would obviously know from the land down under who the Aboriginal people are. I tend to call myself an original man of the land because as we're starting to become a lot aware of many things on this planet, one of those things is the language. And language was a very important part of our culture. And through the language, I feel we may have been a little bit hoodwinked in many respects and guided on a particular path that may not be serving us. So first of all, when I say that word Aboriginal, I look at that word and I see what AB means, Jay. See, AB means to me, and if you look in the dictionary or Google it right now with the technology we have, AB is actually not, just like abnormal, something's not normal. So I like to tend to call myself an original man of the land. And that culture, you know, many of scientists would say only thousands, 40,000 years old. But we're starting to come to learn now, Jay, that the culture has been here from the dawn of time, hundreds and thousands of years old. So I guess the rich line of culture that I talk about, we have a story just like you, just like our guests out there watching. We all have a story. But why it's so significant for me to introduce myself to my culture is because I pay my respects to my ancestors and my elders for giving me the opportunity to be on this platform. So that culture, we live in a matrilineal story. And as we know, many of the cultures, belief systems worldwide, and, you know, a lot of the old paradigm has been ran by a patriarchal, okay? So we're living by the patriarch. That matrilineal side, that feminine energy passes down our story. And our story is quite significant because it's rich with expression, like I said, through language, through creation itself, through the art, as I'm sure you're aware, through the dance, through the animals, and most importantly, through the land, just to name a few. So part of our story, Jay, and I guess this is where I'm going to start diving in, and like I said, I want to create a little bit of an entree for your guests. Not dive in too straight away, dive in too deep, too quickly and fast. It's not fasting today, it's feasting. But we come down from the waters of the Milky Way. And from that point, we are into the darkness of the feminine or the mother's womb. And it is that point that we are navel-gated, or as we say, navigated through her waters into the waters of planet Earth. And we know that Earth is a water planet. 80-90% of the planet's water. So straight away when we're navel-gated through the womb, the darkness, we come out into the light. And waiting there is the doctor, because we've just entered into the waters of planet Earth and we've been docked. And we are nursed through this experience. But the cord is cut and we go into the world. Now we go into kindergarten to learn, to absorb, to be taught, to explore, to adventure. We then going to the next level or the next degree, which is called primary school. And we go up to the years of 1 to 6 years. And we're going to high school because we have just graduated another level or degree, and now we've gone into a higher learning. When we get through the high school, and look, many of us, unfortunately, we don't decide to go through the education system, but we go into the uni versus city or university. And it's funny, Jay, because when I graduated from the university in my love for design at the time, I guess we graduate and then we are cut into the real world. But we come into that world, Jay, and we have brought on so many other things that may not have necessarily been ours, that we may have learnt and been taught by the teacher, by the principal, by the priest if you went to church, by your local soccer coach, football coach, whatever sport it may be, by your uncle, whoever was bringing you up through those years. And we come into this world not really being aware of some of those programs, let's call it, some of those degrees, some of those teachings that may have been taught to us through those degrees of learning. Now, I'm going to do something a little bit different. I just want you to hold that in the thought because I love doing 360s, and I'll come back around. But I just saw the latest Star Wars as I was talking to you, Jay, about. And it really was, I guess, a story that really resonated to many of us and gravitated to us because of that hero's journey. And I was thinking of the name of this one, and it was called Rise of the Skywalker. And that hero's journey that's inside of all of us, and I try and coach this to many, many people that I help through their transformation journeys. But are we really playing out the role of that hero? Or are we just playing the role of those programs, those scripts, all of that stuff that was spelled, you may as well say, to us in primary, high, and university, the university up in the stars. And we never really do set ourselves free. And I guess this year for me, Jay, and this is where I want to reverse or re-engineer my story to hopefully help your viewers to be able to set themselves free or become more aware and in a state of consciousness, which they are going to be able to share their own gifts, their own purpose, their own story. This year's been a big one, Jay. It's been a big, big year. And part of that, there was a lot of peeling back these layers. And I talked to a lot of my guests on my Woke Warrior program about peeling back these layers. What do I mean by that, Ev? What do I mean by layers? I was dissolving a lot of layers, a lot of the surface that may not have necessarily been mine growing up through the childhood. One of those things was separation, relationship. One of those things was the career, closing down a gym that I was involved in. One of those things was definitely being able to let go of one of those layers of the illusion. And one of the big lessons I'm sure we can go into, particularly as men, of control, and accept and surrender to this journey that has really started to unfold for me and many other people that I've started to see through their own hero's journey. Now, before that, Jay, I was in the relationship for a good 4 or 5 years. And before that, I had been in just a contracted, subcontracted personal trainer, as I do now more online, as an online coach and transformation specialist. And I was working for other people. You go back a few years before that, and I was in another relationship that was probably around the same time, maybe 3 years, Jay. And unfortunately, that one fell away as well. And when we're going back, and I'm trying to, like I said, reverse and re-engineer, we're going to get back to that university, that primary, that high school, and that kindergarten. Before that, I was working as a service to others, you might call it, in a men's clothing retail store. But I'd always had this love and passion for helping people, but also for taking care of myself. And one of those things that was definitely guided and pushed in the direction of was health and fitness. And through all of my teenage years, I'd played sports, you name it, cricket, which is more of an English game for you guys over there, football, we call it the real football, soccer, as you guys are aware over there. Man, I even kickboxed. And it was only not later on into my life, before we go back too far, that I started competing. Yeah, interesting term, isn't it, Jay? Competing on stage as a fitness model to be judged. And for 10 years of my life, I was very fortunate to travel the world, close to you guys. One of the pictures that you actually put up today, Jay, was, funnily enough, exactly 12 years ago for a world championship in Canada. And I had traveled to compete on stage and be judged. But never in my mind was it about those couple of things, which we can dive into as well. Because when we go back, and like I said, when I was in the care of my parents, going back into my teenage years now, guys, I hope you're staying with me. That is when a lot of the program that I've started to see through relationships, career, health, wealth, happiness, all of the big ones out there that we discuss in our shows had started to really be formed. And although I wasn't aware like I have been this year, I took on a lot of those programs, Jay, and was hiding in the shadow because of what my brother and I had experienced through the abuse of what we saw our parents go through. And that went on for a good decade, Jay. And I guess if we go into those toddler years, there was a time when my parents I guess, were on and off in relationships and were not always together. So my brother and I, we were moved around a lot. There was never any purpose. There was never any place of stability. So I guess that's where we can talk about where we started to survive. So yeah, Jay, that's a little bit of the story. I don't want to dive in too much deeper because I know and I respect your time and energy, my friend, but I hope and I wish that all you guys could hear that out there.
I want to take a moment to, first of all, thank you and honor you for showing up tonight and your willingness to share some parts of your story that they're your truths. It's part of your life. It's part of your fabric. It's part of it's your experiences that truly impacted you, mind, body, and spirit. And through those experiences, it created opportunities for you to either grow or live in somewhat of a painful existence for yourself. You had sent me a short movie that you had done about your life. It's somewhat of a short bio for your earlier years specifically. And I watched it yesterday and it really impacted me. It was a beautiful piece that you put together and you touched significantly on it, in it, about what it was like to be a child growing up in a home of abuse, how that impacted you. If you may, I'd like to invite you to take a little bit of time here just to kind of go back and at least share with us how it impacted you and how you turned it into your purpose and what that looked like for many years of your life.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you. And to be honest, my friend, I didn't really understand, or overstand what exactly that would look like as we all pretty much go through this world not being aware. And it really has only come down to probably the last, 2 years, 12 months, that I really got that epiphany that I shared in that story this year. And I guess when we go back to that time, to that dark place, that the life I was living was in fear, Jay. It was a life that I wasn't really free to express myself and my purpose, my love, what I wanted to share. So that place was a tough time. It was a tough time, brother. But we so cleverly, Jay, so cleverly, I was able to hide it. And I guess live behind a mask. And, you go to school, like I mentioned, you go to primary school, you go to high school, but you put up this wall, this mask of not being able to express and not tell anyone because you're feeling embarrassed, man. I was probably still even feeling guilty that I couldn't get in there to stop the abuse. You probably don't even feel a value. So there's all of these deep, low vibrational emotions and feelings that you hide for such a long time, for a long time. And I guess just coming into high school, I started to really become aware of some things that may have been hidden, some things that may have been left in the dark, in that shadow. And to what I was not expecting, I started to pick up my first dumbbell. It was actually a sport that was offered in one of our electives just at the back end of the high school. And as I expressed in the video, Jay, that you watched, and I'm happy to share it with anyone that would like to share that video, by the way, it became my religion. It became my ritual. It became my daily habits, my behaviors. Man, there was days that a good friend of mine, we would have been training daily, 7 days a week. And to anyone out there, I don't recommend that sort of training anymore. But it became a part of my life. It was what you might have called my identity.
Mm-hmm. What did it do for you?
It numbed me, I guess, Jay. But it also gave me the expression, the opportunity, and the option to be able to, I guess, release a lot of those deep emotions. And a lot of the people that I help on their health, fitness, and wellness journeys, I do see a lot of aggression, a lot of anger. There's a lot of masculine energy, a lot of electricity pouring out onto those weights, to that exercise, to that movement, whatever it may be. So it really became an opportunity to release. And I hope that makes sense, my friend.
It does. You've mentioned the word armor a few times to me. And I'd like to ask you to share a little bit. Tell me more about that. Well, how did weightlifting become your armor?
Well, I talked a little bit briefly, and great question, Jay, because a lot of the men, as we know, we help, and a lot of women out there too, I'm sure. It could be named mask. It could be named armor. It could be named any of these facades or one of those illusions that we paint for the environment to not really see the true self, to see that spirit within. And I guess that armor, it became protection in the sense that the ego side of the armor, yeah, Jay, you feel tough. You feel strength.
Powerful.
You feel power. Maybe all of that power, that strength that I lacked as that child, not being able to get in the middle of the abuse that I was witness to. I hope that helps.
It does. I'd like to invite you to take a moment just to take a nice deep breath and allow yourself to feel the emotions behind the words that you've just shared in this moment. What are you feeling right now?
Strength. because of the release I feel of some of those low vibratory frequencies and emotions that I'd stored under the armor all of that childhood. I hope that makes sense, brother.
It does. I'd like to take us now on this journey of the hour is when I looked at your Facebook photos and saw you in your days of competition, it was such a moment for me of acknowledgement how we as men, not all of us, but many of us, reach for the dumbbells to bring us a feeling of that we're okay, that we are strong. And as you mentioned the word identity, it you gave yourself permission to be for your external strength and physique and acknowledgments and accolades that you received as a competitor in the field of bodybuilding and modeling to bring you a sense of peace, a sense of I'm okay, a sense of everything's all right. Was that true?
Let me just digest that one, brother. Relief is key word, Jay. Relief. I love that. Very true, my brother. And it's because, I guess part of that empowerment, when you flip the coin, can come, I guess, through an idea of validation. You know, when I receive those accolades like you talk about, and man, you get people in the streets, Jay. People coming up to you that you don't even know, that say, wow, how do I get a body like that? And I think to myself, do you really want to go through what I went through to get a body like this? But it's this constant battle. And one of those key things that we know as men is we always look for that illusion of validation. And I guess that comes down to that father-son relationship. Only to see later on that the validation that I was looking for, it was me. It was me. So I hope that makes sense, my brother.
It does. Once you had the awareness that the validation had to come from within you. And if I may paraphrase you, I think I understood you said that was just in the last couple of years that you began to have this new clarity. Up until that point, you had the physique, you had some validation outside of yourself that you were good enough. Matter of fact, you not only were good enough, but you were great. You were powerful, physically speaking. And when you looked in a mirror, you had, as I think you said earlier, to a degree, you used the word false illusion, a false illusion that everything was okay. But growing up in a home with some significant abuse that you witnessed between your mom and dad had to have had a profound impact on your ability to be relational with people, to be relational in a in a partnership or a relationship with a partner. Share a little bit about that, if you may.
Beautiful question as always, Jay. Beautiful question, my friend. Well, sitting on that question, Jay, I guess when we talk about relationships, and they're quite complex, as all of us know, our viewers or our listeners out there, and how it affected, I guess, my relationships, seeing what I saw from my childhood, it really became aware of some of the more abandonment issues that I may have been facing as a child. I guess some of that idea of feeling guilt within the relationship, but not having a person there to validate love. You know, I learned so much, particularly over this last 12 months, like you mentioned, Jay, in regards to relationships, and a lot of the guests are experts in the field, that the relationship really on a deeper level, that like I just brushed on, is really the relationship with self. Because when we think of relationships in context to what we hear, as many of our viewers, I'm sure, are aware of in this third dimension of polarity, but the relationship is that connection with that other person or that other thing outside of yourself that, again, really pulls you away from the relationship with self. Because we talk about these relationships and how they may have affected our childhood and how I may have brought it into my adulthood, but never once was I thinking about the relationship that I had with my pet, the relationship that I had with my musical instrument at the time when I was learning guitar, the relationship that I had with the paintbrush, because I love painting as well. And like I brushed on at the start, Jay, you know, we come in from these waters, we enter these waters. It's all about ships, isn't it? You know, we have a citizenship. We have all of these ships. The ship is our own vessel. So when we start to relate to that ship, our own vessel, I really feel then, Jay, no matter what adversities, what troubles, what trauma you may have gone through in your childhood, that you're able to bring in that relationship that matches yours and not your own wounding. I hope that makes sense.
Well, that right there is it's the meat of the potato right there. For me, it's a sweet potato these days, just for the record.
good.
I'm doing the white potatoes, but if we tend to, generally speaking, and in a very unconscious way, we come into our adult relationships and seek other people to help us feel better, bring us happiness. We're lacking it within ourselves because we are just on autopilot for much of our life, living in that mind space, that ego space that's driving the car. It's got its hands firmly on a 10 and 2 position on that steering wheel. And we lean into other people to make us feel better. That's an interesting statement there, to make us feel better. it's an oxymoron to a large extent because, well, first of all, no one has the power to make us feel anyway. It's our choice to accept what they're saying as the truth, our truth or not. But more importantly is that we lean into others to bring us what we think is going to be peace, happiness, joy, serenity, calm, ease. And we tend to find, at least I did, that it doesn't work so well. I tried that for almost 30 years in a marriage. And I remember at some point in my marriage, I said to my wife, I said, you know, I'm sad. I feel lonely. I'm not happy. And this may have been one of the most profound things she said to me. She said to me, well, what do you need? And I said to her, I don't know, but you're my wife. So you should know. You should know what I need to feel better. And therein lied the truth of what ended up becoming eventually the end of our relationship as it was, because she had a valid point. She said, well, if you don't know what you need, then how can I know what you need? I'm not a mind reader. And that was her response. And that's in lies. Really, the truth is, like, I didn't even know what I needed because I had lost myself, my true self. And I was just living my belief system of what the modern man's life is supposed to be about. But when it was all said and done, I truly didn't know what I needed, and I didn't know how to get it. And my wife was unable to naturally just give it to me. And so there led, you know, the pathway for decades of being in a relationship that I felt alone in. And I don't think I'm that unusual. I think I'm probably pretty typical. And what I heard you say so eloquently, Evis Heath, is that it's not anyone else's responsibility to give that to us. It's our own. And we already have truly what we need already within us. We just have to slow down enough to learn how to seek it and find it. It's waiting. Truly waiting. And then what we get to have with people outside of ourselves is, instead of an attachment, instead of me being attached to someone else, putting that ultimate responsibility on them to make me feel better about myself, that's no longer what their role in a relationship is. Now I'm taking care of myself. They, hopefully, if we are energetically aligned, they are investing and taking care of their own selves. They're not relying on me, nor am I on them. And when we do come together, it's not about an attachment, a needy attachment, but it's about more of about us connecting at the soul to soul level, because we're both either at peace with who we are, or we're working on creating, or just not really creating, because we already are there. But just really in that self-discovery phase, which I'm not sure we ever truly are out of. There's always more to learn as we mature and grow. So if I may ask, from you having been on this self-discovery journey now for a couple of years, what have you learned about yourself and your capacity to be present in a healthier relationship?
Let me just say, first of all, Jay, I honor your story, my brother. Beautiful. Beautiful. Thank you for sharing that, my man.
You're welcome.
I can't, Cannot wait to have you on the platform at the end of the week. But to answer your story, bringing it to this present moment, you know, what have I taken from that? And you hit it so eloquently also, Jay, you know, we're mirroring this connection, brother. You say that word, connect. You're able to connect. It no longer is a relate or relationship. It is a connection. And I guess from all of my awakening, my research, my studies, my continuous reading of books, listening to speakers worldwide like yourself, you start to connect and tune in to the vibratory frequency that is aligned to you. So one thing for me, Jay, I'm not in a rush to go looking outside. Because when I was looking outside, I did lose here. I did lose me. So now that I've been able to find me once again, I've been able to fill my own cup, my brother. And both of our backgrounds, we help a lot of people on their health wellness journeys. It takes us, as we always say, our own ability to fill our own cups before we can fill anyone else's. So that's one thing that I've really, really worked on, particularly this year. And been able to do it, I feel, successfully through my daily practices, like I said, through my awareness, and through just being present.
Beautiful.
From just being, Jay, from just being me.
Beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. I love that. I'd like to take a moment here to just again thank those that joined us this evening. For you tomorrow, it's you're about 18 hours ahead in Australia. It is your Monday, I believe. And so for those of you that are joining us live on replay, we appreciate you. We appreciate your support. If you should have any questions for Evis or myself, please put them up on the comments and we'll do our best to either answer them with what time we do have left and or when we watch the replay, we will acknowledge any questions you may have. I'd like to welcome and do thank Mary Kelly for being in a studio with us this evening, Monica Allen, Wendy Ratliff. Thank you for being here, as well as I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing this name right, Elid McLeod, coming in from Scotland. Thank you for acknowledging you are coming in from Scotland. That means a lot to both Evis and I. Getting back to Pamela also. Pamela, thank you for joining us. Anita Johnson says, hello, guys. You know what I love about this? This is the first show platform that I launched coming up on a year and a half ago, Real Men, Real Talk Raw. And it was a vision I had about a year earlier. And my purpose was I really felt that men need a space to come in that are ready to really be vulnerable and honest and authentic and share their backstories, the stories of how it was. But even more importantly is how it is, you know, to share how they have perhaps transformed their own lives from surviving to thriving. And so I'd like to ask you, Evis, you had mentioned in some comments about EI, known as emotional intelligence. Why don't you take a few moments to maybe share with us real briefly what emotional intelligence means to you and how it has impacted your own life's journey?
Beautiful question, Jay. And, you know, I guess where I want to start with that answer, my brother, and why I talk about emotional intelligence, and remember, this is from my perspective, is because we're so involved in AI at the moment, artificial intelligence. And when I look at EI, or emotional intelligence, and particularly for us men, there is a lack of awareness of what even emotions are. You know, I've listened to some beautiful speakers around the world, Jay, and one of those guys that really resonated, and I'm sure a lot of the viewers and listeners are out there, thank you for watching and understand and know. But Dr. Joe Dispenza talks a lot about emotions and the science of emotions. And one thing that really clicked with Dr. Joe and resonated with me was that awareness of, firstly, knowing what emotions are. Because for that left side of brain, that masculine brain of mine, Jay, I need to know some science, man. And then there's that right-hand side, or that feminine side. Some might say the other way around. But like I said, this is my perspective. Where the emotions, they can be pretty much all over the shop. So when I think about the emotions and what they actually are, and when I understood the science that these things we called emotions, or as we know, energy in motion, are actually enforced, validated, enhanced, whatever word you may use that's significant for you and helps you relate, by peptides from a place in our brain called the hypothalamus. Now, these emotions, Jay, are highly addictive. And let me just say that again, they are highly addictive. And I think with a lot of the work that I help, a lot of people that I help on their journeys, is becoming aware that emotions are like chemicals. And that addiction to that emotive or emotional reaction can really be an issue or cause to a lot of the problems we have in life. Now, if we come from the other angle and we don't so much react, but come from a place of the heart through discernment, and take in a certain event, person, or situation that may have happened to us, and more so respond to that particular situation, event, or time or place, then now to me, Jay, we're starting to be more emotionally intelligent. I hope that makes sense.
Always. It always makes sense. Now, even when it doesn't make sense, it makes sense because it's yours. It's your truth. I appreciate you sharing that with me. You had mentioned also how to go from surviving to thriving in a new age. Tell me more.
Well, I guess like I opened up the broadcast at the start and I talked a little bit about my culture. Jay, not only my culture are in survival mode. My community, and I was just talking to one of the brothers here this morning, are still celebrating what is called Survival Day. We are still celebrating a day called Sorry Day.
Wow.
Now, can you see where I'm coming from, Jay? If we are celebrating those particular words and aren't aware of what is actually behind the vibrations of being in survival mode or feeling sorry for, then my brother, I think we've got a problem going into the new age. And for all of our viewers out there, worldwide, universal, or whatever broadcast or frequency you've picked up, I don't want to be in survival mode anymore. I don't want to have to run from the tiger. Yeah, I might want to switch that on if I actually do. But from many, many people that I help, they are running from that tiger 24/7. And as you know, Jay, it's not about being in survival mode. It's about being in thrival mode. Let's celebrate being. Not doing, not surviving, not running from that tiger. Let's just celebrate being.
How do we get there? If all we know how to do is run for our life in fear of getting hurt or getting killed, how do we turn off that switch? Now, maybe that's another show.
It's a beautiful show, brother.
You know, that could be an hour long.
Let's just keep it simple. All right, Jay, I'm going to say one word. Consciousness. That's how we flick that switch, my brother. Consciousness.
If someone is not aware that they're sleeping, they're not conscious, they're unconsciously conscious. Do you think that you can awaken them, or do they have to be ready to awaken?
Jay, this is our birthright. You know, and I know, brother, I've been flicking switches on left, right, and center, helping people on their health and fitness journeys. So it may take someone, a mentor, a coach, a support group, may even take an event to facilitate in the switching of that. But like you said, to some degree, brother, it does take that desire, that want from that person to help and assist in being able to awaken to that. And there's a lot of, let's say, you know, unconscious people. But it only takes a little bit of guidance, a little bit of support. And most importantly, my brother, just listening to someone, and you facilitate in themselves becoming aware of this consciousness.
Thank you. Two words. What do they mean to you? F and F. Forgiveness is the first word. What does forgiveness mean to you?
Letting go.
Thank you. Second word, freedom.
expression, brother.
Wow. Tell me more. Tell me more. What does that word mean to you, expression?
Freedom to express your soul's journey, your purpose, your spirit, your source, your creation, whatever you want to call it. There's plenty of terms. But freedom to be able to express who you are.
You know, you got me there. It just activated an emotion in me big time, because very early on in my healing journey, back in October of 15, I was so shut down from the freedom to express my truths. My body was physically shutting down. I was near death. It had taken, my body was, had no, nothing left to give. It was in shutdown mode. And I've shared this before on a few of my other conversations I've had on a show, is as I laid in a hospital, I asked myself one question. Only one. Do I want to live or do I want to die? And I had the answer, and the answer was I wanted to live. But then the second question was, what is that going to have to look like? And I knew in that moment that what that meant for me was I had to be willing to let go. As you shared before, what forgiveness meant for you is letting go. I had to be willing to let go of who I had become. And every aspect of my life, including my, at the time, my wife, we were married for close to 30 years. I had to be willing to lose everything in order to gain my life, in order to live. Most importantly, in order to come home to myself. And so for me, that the first step was surrender. The second step was truly learning how to have courage to change. And the third step was, for the first time in my life, creating safe spaces where I could learn how to express myself and begin to share all of my truths, all of them, the darkest secrets, and just all of the darkness. You know, for us to, you have to break through the darkness to come to the light. And so began my healing journey. We are over the hour, Evis, and so I would like to, believe it or not, that time I know goes pretty quick when you're in that seat that you're sitting in.
Especially with us, Jay.
But I would like to ask you 5 questions. The first question is, what is your best quality and why? Or I'll rephrase that. What do you love about yourself the most today and why?
My ability to listen to others.
Thank you. If you had 3 months to live, what would you do? And do you think you are living it today?
Oh, beautiful question, Jay. I like it. I'll answer the first part of that question. I'm definitely a wanderer, my brother. I love to go walk about. So I'd 100% travel this beautiful planet and seek more wisdom and knowledge from other cultures worldwide and be able to hopefully share my gift to help them ascend or reach their full potential in expressing their truth.
Beautiful. Avis Heath, who is your hero?
good one. Me.
Tell me more. Why is that?
I'm digesting it, my brother. The journey. I started talking off. I started talking off about that hero's journey, my brother. And I'll finish it on this, my friend, because I love Star Wars. And it comes down to that last scene in Star Wars. And I don't want to spoil alert for everyone out there that hasn't watched it. Turn away. But there is a scene where the feminine and the masculine are sitting down together. Now, above them is the darkness, quote unquote, emperor that sits awaiting for them to show anger, destruction, all of those low vibratory emotions to bring him down and kill him. Because he says that is the life force. It was the true sacred union playing out in that movie, Jay. And I guess I feel that I've been able to balance it as well. So it was who I've become on this journey, my brother.
Beautiful. Thank you for that. What has been your biggest epiphany during your journey of self-discovery?
Well, man, like I said, there's been quite a few. But I would have to say definitely, Jay, and I guess, yeah, we could just about finish on this. I guess why I was building the armor, the body, the mask. And I was building it all along because I was still the child wanting to protect or just be able to come in between and stop the abuse. I guess it would have to have been that, Jay.
Thank you for sharing that this with me. There is one last question for you.
You've got some good ones here, brother.
If you have one word that could save our humanity, what would it be?
Well, Jay, you're going in deep, brother.
This is real men, real talk raw. You know, it's not every day that I get a real man that shows up ready to talk smack.
I don't want to sound cliche, my brother. Love. L-O-V-E, my man.
What does it take for us to create love in society?
Come on, Jay. We're talking a lot of episodes here, my brother. It's a complex, it's a big one, but let's just go with this, brother. It's the yearning for knowledge of self. Awareness and consciousness. Nothing else will bring humanity together, my brother. It's consciousness.
You know, I love your answer. A number of the questions I asked you, you answered the same exact answer that I would have said. But I would like to piggyback this last question, because from my experience of having gone through what I've gone through in my own life, my own healing journey, there were two things that were lacking in my life. One was consciousness, because I've already acknowledged I was unconsciously living the American dream, chasing it for decades, successfully. I made millions of dollars. I had a beautiful wife, the cars, the homes, three sons, the vacations. I had it all. But I was empty. I was empty inside. And what I lacked truly at the core, at the root, was an unconsciousness. It was self-love. I didn't love myself. I lost myself. By the time I was a teenager, I was already gone. I was already disconnected from myself, at my soul source, my soul level. Disconnected from that little boy, JJ, that little inner child. And so for me, the antidote for true healing, the awakening from within, has been the discovery of learning how to first like myself and eventually how to fall in love with myself.
100%, brother. Beautiful.
Do you have any questions or closing thoughts that you'd like to kind of play back on me in this moment? Because I'm giving you that opportunity.
I just want to say, Jay, like I said last week, and we only just connected, my brother, but the platform that you're providing is more than just a broadcast. And as we know, there's a lot of meaning and a lot of reasons why these broadcasts are so effective, important. But my thing that I want to say, Jay, is more out of gratitude. And that's because this is a healing platform. So thank you.
You're welcome. And on that note, just again, my acknowledging, I want to just honor you and let you know how humbled I am and truly in gratitude that you showed up today and you were willing to deep dive into your truths, into some of your painful wounds, experiences that impacted your life through a lifetime, part of a lifetime tattoo that you have today let go of, continue to release, dissolve, so that you can live the life that you were born to live, like all of us were born to do. And so thank you so much for joining me. If you could stay in the studio just for a few moments so we can kind of have a little bit of time off air together, I'd appreciate that. Again, for those of you that joined us this evening, I appreciate you so much for showing up and supporting both Evis Heath and myself in this conversation between two men that are on our own awakening journey of self-discovery, self-love, and so that we can show up for others and come from our own heart space, sharing our own experiences, our own truths, and most importantly, our love and kindness, so that perhaps you can be inspired and have hope for your future, that it's possible that you could have the life that you've always wanted. It takes courage, it takes commitment, it takes surrender, being willing to do whatever it takes to heal, to come home to yourself. And with that, Merry Christmas if you're celebrating in the Jewish faith, Happy Hanukkah for those across the world. I'm not sure if I'm gonna have a show coming in this week or not. I may take the week off for the holiday, but I honor all of you. Thank you for being in my life today. Allow me to hopefully impact a part of your life that that you'd like to see improve or change or bloom. And with that, thank you for joining us on Real Men, Real Talk, Raw. Happy New Year.